Hi, this is Graham, and thanks for joining me on the third instalment of part 3 of understanding the FZ200 camera from Panasonic. In the previous video, we looked at some of the focus modes, and in particular the autofocus modes and the manual focus mode, and we discussed the autofocus tracking and the manual focus setup. Now, in this video, I want to try and demonstrate the difference between the AFS, which is a single shot autofocus, the AFF, which is the autofocus flexible mode, which is a new addition to this camera, and the AFC, which is the autofocus continuous. The difference between the AFF and the AFC is in the way the camera determines the focus position. In the AFF, which is the autofocus flexible, when the shutter is held in the halfway down position, the camera continuously scans the image and tries to correct for any focus deviation. So it doesn't matter if the subject is approaching or going away from the camera will attempt to hold the focus on the object. In the AFC mode, again when you half depress the shutter button, the camera will continuously calculate the focus position, but it depends on the speed and distance of the object. So it's calculating a velocity component and then trying to adjust the camera focus to compensate for that speed of the object. It does depend on the size of the object in the frame. It depends on whether the object is moving straight towards the camera or diagonally across it as to whether the camera will actually pick up the change in velocity or the change in subject distance. For example, if the subject is approaching the camera directly, then the camera only knows the subject is changing position by the size change in the object. If the subject is moving diagonally across the camera, then the camera can try and predict the focus distance based on the velocity of the object. So whilst you're half depressing the shutter button, the camera is constantly refocusing the camera to predict the next position the object will be at the point that you've pressed the shutter button to take the image. It does this at the frame rate of the camera, so it's 100 frames per second if you are a 50 frames per second camera, or it's at 120 frames per second if you've got the NTSC version of the camera. I'm going to try and demonstrate that with this little train that's running around the track. I'll first of all take a picture in the AFS, which is a single shot mode, and I'll focus it on the train at the back of the track and take a picture, and then I'll try and capture the same image when the train has reached the front of the track. So I'll lock focus when the train is at the back and take the picture when the train is at the front. And you should see that once the train has reached the front of the track, and the AFS mode won't correct for this as it's not designed to. When I switch to the AFF mode, again I'll focus on the train at the back of the track and take the picture at the front of the track. And we should see that the camera has tracked that train and will allow us to get a better picture. We'll try this with AFC as well, although the change in direction and velocity component might not be sufficient for the camera to calculate a focus distance. But we'll try it. So I'm first going to set the camera to AFS. So we'll go up to the menu, down into the menu, and across to the AF single shot. And first of all, I'll take it when it's at the back of the track. And now I'm going to do the same thing. I'll lock focus when it's at the back, and I'll take the picture when it's at the front. And you should be able to see that train is slightly out of focus. Now I'm going to switch over to the AFF mode. And again, we'll take the same shot, we'll take it at the back of the track and at the front of the track. And now we'll switch over to the AFC mode. And again, I'll lock focus when the train reaches the back of the track and take the picture at the front. So we've seen how difficult it is for the camera to actually track focus if the subject is moving. So you really have to experiment between AFF and AFC to find out which one will give you the best result under the situation that you're trying to take the photograph. I now want to look at two options in the setup menu which you can use in the semi-automatic modes, and they are the Intelligent Resolution Mode and the Intelligent Dynamic Range. They're found in the Setup menu, so if I access the Setup menu, they're on page 4 for the i.resolution, and the options again are to have it off, on, or apply Intelligent Zoom. If we have it in the on position, the camera, when it takes a photograph, will actually apply sharpening in a slightly different way to the image. It will look for areas of edge contrast, so for example on the pipework around this train and on the lettering and anywhere where there's a division between shadow and highlight, it will try and sharpen that. Gives the appearance of a slightly sharper picture, but it can overdo it, and it's best to take one shot and find out how it's treating it. And if you can see any artifacts, for example, if you're outside taking a picture with trees, if you are seeing halos around the branches, then it's applying too much sharpening, and I would suggest you take eye resolution off. I'm going to reduce the ISO to ISO 100 so we get the maximum sharpness from the camera. First shot with eye resolution enabled. And the second shot, I will take the eye resolution off. In Intelligent Zoom, the camera will now apply digital zoom up to times 2. If you notice at the scale at the bottom now, we have a digital zoom applied of times 2. So the eye resolution will allow the camera to use 2 times digital zoom, giving you a total magnification of times 48. So in some circumstances, it just gives you that extra edge to give you a longer focal range. If you combine the eye resolution set to Intelligent Zoom along with digital zoom, you can get the full times 4 digital zoom, taking you up to times 96. So if we enable digital zoom in the menu, we turn that on. When I go back to the picture taking mode and I use the zoom lever, you can now see we can zoom up to the times 48, which is the eye zoom, and then we can go beyond that to times 96 for the digital zoom. And I'll take an image at that to show you in the video. If I turn off the digital zoom, and of course you can use the full digital zoom, which is times 4, with the optical zoom, giving you a total of times 96 zoom in the video mode. So turning off digital zoom just allows us to use the times 48 combined 2 times digital and 24 times optical zoom to give us times 48, and I'll take the image, you can have a look at that. And that's the times 24 times optical zoom for comparison. The other option is the i.dynamic. So we'll just turn off eye resolution for the moment. And the eye dynamic is on page 3. And we have 3 settings: low, standard, and high. The eye dynamic mode is a way in which the camera tries to compress a range of tones that normally wouldn't be able to be captured by the camera. So for example, if you've got extreme highlights and extreme shadows, this feature tries to compress the highlights and boost the shadows to enable the picture to be taken. The overall contrast is a lot lower than a standard picture, so you may prefer a standard style with the fact that the highlights might be slightly blown out or the shadows are slightly blocked, in preference to a picture which is quite flat. Again, you could process that slightly, but the results don't come out too good in my opinion. Anyway, we'll look at some of the pictures taken with the i.dynamic set to high, standard and low. Compare that to a standard shot with it off. So I'll set i.dynamic high first of all, and we'll take the first picture. You can probably already see from the preview picture that the black of the background has now become a lighter shade, and the black of the engine has become a lighter shade as the camera's trying to compensate for the extreme tone range. So here's the first picture with the camera set to i.dynamic high. I will set i.dynamic to the standard setting, and again we'll take a picture. You can probably see the background has gone slightly blacker. Now I'll turn the i.dynamic to low. And the final shot, I'll turn i.dynamic off. You can probably now see that the background is perfectly black and the engine is darker. In the scene menu, which I've got displayed now, there is the HDR mode, which is the high dynamic range, which takes a multiple of shots to combine them into one image with an increased tonal range. So with the same shot set for HDR, this is the result. It's a personal preference, but I just don't like the way the camera flattens the image in the i.dynamic mode. So here are some pictures I shot last week using the i.dynamic mode in a situation where I wanted to try and capture detail in the feathers of these ducks. As you can see, the camera has increased the tonal range, it's captured more detail, but at the expense of pushing up the ISO, and you can see a lot more noise in the background and the picture's quite flat. Compare that to a normal shot taken without i.dynamic mode, and I've just reduced the exposure compensation to try and capture the highlight detail. I know which I prefer, but again, I'll leave that choice to you, and whether you use i.dynamic or not, again, that choice is down to you. So that's it for the first section of the semi-automatic modes, the P mode. In the next video in this series, I want to start looking at the aperture priority and shutter priority modes, which give you the ability to set the aperture to so you can select the amount of depth of field you want, or you can set the shutter speed, for example, if you want to stop action in a sports scene, or you can use it to extend the shutter speed to capture silky water on rivers and things like that. And again, you can use the manual mode to get very creative by changing the ISO, the shutter speed and the aperture, all independent, to give you the desired effect that you want. So until next time, thanks again for watching, and it's Graham saying bye for now.